Hello, thank you very much for checking out a bit of What Was That Radio. My name is John Williams, and What Was That Radio is a 24/7 radio station that you can listen to via the apps or whatwasthatradio.com. I'm live weekdays between 10 a.m. and 1 p.m. Pacific as I broadcast from Vancouver Island on the west coast of Canada. It's also an arts academy, a community of wuzzers, and a podcast that splits two ways. A conversation with, and much like this one with Jack, of Psychedelic Porn Crumpets. Conversations that can go hours and hours long. Then there's What Was Short, where my best friend and podcast editor Mike Battle chooses his favourite little nugget and says, bam, here's a 10-minute starting point into the minds of these just creators. I was going to say collaborators with me in speaking, yes, but these people that have galvanised my soul. Man, Jack is so talented. He's band of Psychedelic Porn Crumpets out of Perth, Australia. Tremendously so. What a thrill to chat with him. And thanks again for your time and checking it out.
Hello.
Hello.
How you doing, man?
I'm good. How are you? How's your day going?
Pretty good. Pretty good. I literally just woke up.
Did you?
And your room looks incredible. That is a trip down and a half. Fish tank? That's sick.
Yeah, there's a few things going on. Your internet got a bit laggy for a second there, but I'll give you the quick rundown on this room that I can't really take credit for, Jack. It's more my partner Jodie and her creation than it is me.
Yeah, okay.
But she loves the 70s. What, you're on that one. She loves the 70s. Yeah, we've got the fish tank at Christmas. We've got Harley, who's 8 years old, her son upstairs, who they had a little fish tank, and then I've been in here for about 2 years now, and I was like, let's get a slightly bigger one and get some neons, some psychedelic neons back there. We've got the classic 1970s. Can you see the 1970s exercise bike behind me?
I can. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll show you how it works quick.
Hey, right, that's good.
Realizing now the mic was probably blocking the camera for you.
It's like the opposite of a penny farthing, really, isn't it?
Did you hear how fucking loud it was as well?
I could hear it too,
This is extreme gates and it's so loud.
Yeah. Do you need me to be recording my audio here?
You don't have to, but if you want to, that's marvelous.
All right. If that's easy for you, because I can just chuck it through. I'll just have to put some headphones on, but I'll put it, send you like a WAV?
Yeah, MP3 or whatever, Google Drive it or whatever's clever for you.
All right, let me crank this for 1 second. You might go off.
That's okay.
But I'll just crank Ableton, get that going. All right, audio.
Okay. Whilst you do that, I'm going to quickly let everyone know that you've joined.
All good. I think I've got audio coming through from you, though, as well. I'm recording that, so is that all right if you can hear the computer one as well?
Yeah, sure. It's all good. Yeah. Marvellous. Okay. Jack has joined me. Fabulous. So what's the usual morning routine like for you? Do you like to earn your breakfast like Orlando, or do you just get on with it?
I don't know. I usually wake up a little bit dusty. It's a couple of beers beforehand. I had a few friends over last night, and then the neighbor next door, we got two old Italian neighbors who gave me like this big apple cake kind of thing. And I haven't had cake in ages, so I woke up in the morning, I was like, man, that looks so good. And I ate like half of it. So I'm on a cup of tea now, had a cigarette. Then I do the old blur routine and think about leaving the house.
There we go. Yeah. Oh my God. That's one of my favorite. Yeah. One of my favorite movies of all time, man. I would love to write something with Simon Pegg, Nick Frost, and Edgar Wright so bad.
Yeah.
So it's a pleasure to speak to you, man. I've been so enthralled with your mind and your creations for the last couple of years here. And I've got cheekily Scheiger's on the top of the deck behind me there above the fish tank. I don't know if you can see that.
I saw it. I saw it. Thank you very much.
That was a Christmas present from my partner, Jody, who's upstairs watching this on the laptop with Harley. And I had gone into my local record store, Vinyl Envy, and tried to order it. And I was like, I don't want to order it through the website because I'm going to get hit with all these massive charges and income tax and blah, 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 blah. And they were like, oh, we've got one. We can get one. And then this was about 2 weeks before Christmas. And then I go in there and they're like, oh, no, it's not here. And then it's under the tree. Sneaky, sneaky partners.
Oh, amazing. Oh, that's great. Is the, what do you call it? Because how much is it for shipping from where you are then, if it's on our online store or like from wherever, or you don't really know?
It was going to be about $35 Canadian to ship it.
Because it's just criminal at the moment. Because we've just, obviously we've got that new record coming out, but we're trying to talk to people about how we can sort of condense the price into just like, I don't know, getting a distributor in each sort of place rather than that one-off. Because at the moment, some places, the shipping's more than the record. So you're just like, oh, some commodity that's like, it's really difficult to try and ship at the moment. But we'll plan it. We'll work it out.
But how are you even sourcing the wax in the first place? Because it's not as if it's a worldwide issue.
There's been about, I think it's been a 10-month wait. So like, it's almost like, I don't know, if there was another sort of medium. I suppose for us, it's easy to leave the records. Like, I suppose we're a bit of a vinyl band, or we've always thought of ourselves to be a record band. So the release is almost, we're waiting for that record to come out on wax before we put it out online, because you sort of want it to be, I don't know, you want a physical copy, and that's how we've sort of started with the record label, What Reality. So, but now it's getting to the point where the music is like moving quicker than the production of what we can actually put out physically. So it's weird. I suppose it's a good problem to have, but we're just sort of backlogging everything. And then 6 months later, when it's eventually ready to come out, you're like, man, I don't even know if I like it anymore. So you kind of want to move with it.
But that in itself, with What Reality Records that you launched 5.5 years ago-ish at this point, even, okay, because this is what intrigues me about. So quick context on me, because I don't expect you to share anything without knowing a little bit about me. But I have been in modern rock broadcasting for a decade. I moved from the south of England, from near Swindon, to Canada, because my mum's side of the family, grandparents, are from the island here on Vancouver Island. I'm on the west coast. And when she passed away 14 years ago, we had a little get together in Toronto. And that was the first time I'd really left England, to be honest with you. And then decided to backpack across Canada, and then giving out radio demos all along the way. I've been making radio demos since I was like 4 or 5 years old. And John Peel and Johnny Wright and those classic English DJs that I know you'll know of as well are the big inspirations for me. But I was never going to get a DJ job when I was 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. So skip forward. I moved here because I'd exhausted everything I could in England, work experiences and demos and everything in between. And I got a job at the station called The Zone at 91.3 on the island here, which is where I was at for 10 years. And really, What Was That Radio was born out of a lust to keep growing. I love radio, whether it's commercial, online, or anything in between. But I also love being as in the moment as possible. And as much as I love going to Triple J or Radio 1 to discover things as well, it's a whole different universe of radio and broadcasting and being in the moment. And it's a lot more particular, and that's fine. But I wanted to really push myself to do as much as I could. That's why I'm so fascinated to speak to you, because you very quickly, it's not like you've been involved in trying to make your own tunes since you were a little boy. But it's in the last 5, 6, 7 years that you've really gone, okay, I'm going to fucking do this. I'm going to launch that. I'm going to jump into this. I'm going to do this as well. And so to bring back, after a little contextual share about myself, to bring it back to my point, Jack, which is we're talking about records right now in 2022 pandemic. We didn't know it was going to be like this. But when you set up What Reality Records in 2017, what was the process like then with the first few records?
Oh, man, that was like, it was interesting, because we had Rhubarb Records, who was the record company. So that was Dylan, our friend. He came to us and approached us about doing a small run of 500 records of High Visceral Part 1. And so I think at that point we were just like, we've made it. Like, we get our record onto vinyl and it's on wax. And it's like, that just felt like, cool, we're actually a real band now. Like, I think we'd all been in bands before, and it's like, you put a release out, you put a little Bandcamp thing, maybe your mom pays like $5 for it. So to sell even like 50 copies, we were just like, what? Like, this is insane. And then we had a couple, Dylan was really kind to us. He said, like, this is how I've been doing it. He was like, I did 500 records. We went 50-50 with him. And he just basically said, like, if you do it yourself, you can get 100% of the profits. And, like, and sort of just showed us, like, the model of how to package, how to ship it. And we bought, like, a couple of stamps. And so we did a small run of 500 records. So I think that was part one again, like, once they'd sold out. But obviously, it took, like, a year to sell out those first 500. And I think it took about 2 months to sell out the next. And it's obviously built to the point, like, those records, we still own the, like, the publishing royalties on them. So we didn't send them off to, like, anyone else. So we can just put them out when we want. But it's nice that they've become, like, almost that we've kept the supply of them really low. So there's a nice cat.
That's Theodore, yeah. Named after my favorite chipmunk. Yeah.
Off the Alvin and the chipmunk.
Yeah, he usually jumps up and joins us. You going to get up or not? As he's licking his lips. No. He's just had some dinner.
Yeah. But no, it was just like, I think we were just, well, it wasn't even that long ago, but it feels like you were, like, we were 3 years old. I didn't know what was going on. I, like, didn't own a record player for years. So it was kind of, I felt like it was a bit of a cheat. I was like, oh, like, we're doing this. Obviously, like, making music. But so Rish got his hands pretty full on with that. And we'd send, basically use this company, X Vinyl X, was still Dylan's company here. I think that was the Czech plant. It was manufacturing those. But back then it was like a 9-week turnaround. It was like 3 months. And they would sometimes come a lot quicker. So when we were finished with the masters, you send them off and you sort of had that sort of campaign to be like show, tour, wait for, I don't know, the first single to sort of come out. And you knew that those 3 months was like the album campaign run. And then afterwards, however long it lives, if you're touring it, it'll be great. But now obviously with like the 10-month wait and the not touring, and like when we released Shiger, like it was so sad because you were just like, the album sort of just went like, we feel like there was a lot of our better work that we've done recently on that record. And especially live when we go and play it, like we've only played it in Perth, so we haven't gone anywhere with it. So album life cycles are sort of just lasting maybe a month or two. Whereas before they could have lasted like a year and a half and you could tour on them. But I still think like we'd move along quicker and we don't want to outdo what we've got, but it'll be nice to sort of, I don't know, what even is normal anymore? There's no comparison of what it can be or what it should have been. But I think we're just happy to keep writing music. And hopefully there's a quicker way of getting vinyl manufactured. There's not like a year to wait. So it'll be nice.
Yeah. I mean, I don't certainly have any answers. We'll just have to wait and see how it all shakes down. It just seems to be, it's just so fascinating how one little glitch can create such manic effect.
Well, we were thinking about like if there's something else we could just create it out of. Like I know there's those X-ray sheets that like people were doing records on. You can get like straight like meltdown frisbees or something.
Yeah.
And we're just sort of find different ways of putting records out. But then I suppose like you've got a style of or a product which now I wish we didn't go like full colors straight off the bat because now you're like, where do we go now? It's like, we should have built up to it rather than being like, this is the best we've ever done. And it's just like, all right, how many ways can you make three color variation splatters look amazing? There was one really good one. Do you know Vinyl Williams?
Vinyl Williams?
Yeah, he's John. You're John Williams as well, aren't you?
Yeah.
Did you say your name is John Williams? Yeah. Composer?
Do people crack that joke often?
No.
Is that what you're asking? Sorry, or because you glitched for a second.
I was saying just John Williams is Vinyl Williams' grandson. So I was like, oh, is there any relation to Vinyl?
Right.
Well, obviously, yeah.
If there was, but, this room would be more expensive looking. I don't know how to, you know. There might be some Hercules posters on the wall or something. I don't know. Gladiator, pardon me.
A Spielberg sort of replica face mask or something.
He's just hanging out in the kitchen.
But he's got some really cool vinyl variations. Like they're like some, I don't even know what they're called. They're all different names, aren't they? Like Sherbet Galaxy or something. It's like whatever it is. But
yeah, but I love how nonchalant you are about that when you're the king of fantastic song titles.
The king of fantastic song titles. I'll take that.
You know, Sawtooth Monkfish, Big Dijon, The Terrors, hats off to The Green, just going through Shiger because I love it so much. But your song titles, they make me chuckle before I even get to the whimsical sharings of your lyrical style. I just feel like I'm just hanging out with you all the time. Just, it's just your musings. It's not, it doesn't seem to be too aggressively overthought. It's just, and obviously I've watched a few interviews as well that you've done in the last few months, because that's how I prepare for things. But most of the time I like to just go with my gut instinct, especially with a band I've discovered like you only in the last few years alone. I don't want to distort too much of other people's opinions. Just want to get to the source and figure it out with you. But yeah, I mean, it's almost as well. What also comes to mind is that that's also like every fucking marijuana name when you go in, because it's all legalized here, right? So you, oh, what do you want? The Sherbert, the 1-2-3 step, the Snoop Drizzle, the Wit Flipple. Oh my God, yeah. It just goes on and on.
You're going to wake up in a hole and not regret it.
So. Yeah. I don't know, though, but is that pressure that you put on yourself that you feel, I shouldn't have done the color too early? I mean, what I want to go back to even further is what propelled you to start the record label? I've got a bunch of friends in a band called Colorado that started Royal Mountain Records, that has become one of the most incredible record labels out of Canada that you most likely know of. And they did it just because they were like, fuck it, no one wants to sign us. Like, what was the galvanizing thought behind yours?
Yeah, pretty much a very similar thing to that. Like, we had, obviously at the time when we were coming out, you had Tame Impala and Pond, which were on Spinning Top Records, and they're literally like down the road. So we were just like playing gigs, and the guy who mixed our record, Jelly, he was like in the Growls, and he played with Cam Avery and played in the band with Kevin and stuff. So I think we were just knocking on the door of them all the time, sending them messages, being like, please sign us, like our music's similar and whatever. And then we didn't really hear anything back. And then obviously Giz was down the road, like, well, they're in Melbourne, not down the road, they're about 4,000 miles away, but they're down the road. Yeah. And obviously they were just pumping out, their record label, Flightless. And so I think it was like taking that model of what we liked at the time. It seemed that the bands that we were listening to released everything on their own label independently. And I think it was until sort of later on that you found out like maybe Modular was with Kevin and they were doing Tame and Pond was on some label. But it seemed at the time it was like Spinning Top, they must get $1 million a week because they're shipping out records everywhere. So I think it was like more so just a way that we could not have to wait or ever be just like, yeah, waiting to put something out. So if it was, say, we've released a record, there was no waiting. I can't even think of another word. But yeah, like we could move with the time of the band, and it wasn't like we were doing anything that anyone else was trying to tell us to do. So it was just very independent in that way. But also, yeah, I think what was going on in like the West Coast of America with California-based bands. So we were listening to a lot of OCs and they were putting out records themselves, and then watched Ty Segall and like he had his own thing and Wand. Or what it seemed like, everyone had their own little label. So we were like, oh, it's just like part of the music scene. So, and we also had a bunch of friends' bands that were like, we'll sign them until you realize that we'd spend all our money trying to help them. And yeah, it's a good indicator to be like, if you're good enough, like, and it works, you could make a nice little career for yourself where you don't have to sort of be someone else's puppet and do bits and pieces. And if you fail on by your own accord, then it kind of feels a little bit nicer than being let go from someone else and owing them a bunch of money. Like, the worst thing we can do is not sell records, but that's purely down to us because the music's not good enough. So it's sort of like you've only got yourself to fail, if that makes sense.
Absolutely, it does. Did you have any experience with labels in any other projects beforehand at all?
Like, we went from, I don't know, working on building sites to occasionally having, I mean, I've always jammed and played in bands, but it was just the occasional gig. We were like just getting a Saturday night gig in like some bands. We're always a Tuesday night, Wednesday night. Like, man, like, how do you get a gig on a weekend? Like,
yeah, I know, right?
Yeah. And I think that was the, always put down in the basement as well, the Swan basement. We did our days there. But that was, I think the first time we got a gig on a Saturday, we were like, that was it. That was our sort of Oasis moment going when they played in Scotland to old mate, they'll get that support thing. We're like, we're a band. There have been a few of those, but even now it feels further away than it did then. Like, there's never going to be a thing that's like, I don't know, a capping moment to like what we've achieved. I think it's always, let's see how far we can go and what music we can make. And it's nice that, I don't know, we've always said Glastonbury would be like a real cool like checkpoint. We can just
Oh, that would be incredible.
Yeah, that would be something we're aiming at. And 5 years ago, that seemed like the highest thing to sort of aim at. And now you're almost like, we're nearly fucking there.
It's kind of, it's so close. The Evises have got to love the shit out of your band. They can't not. Like, it's so good. And that's in and around where I grew up, down in Wiltshire and Gloucester as well. So it's fascinating for me, because I'll speak for me, because it's in order to unlock a little bit more about you, in the sense of, again, why I wanted to step away from being a part of a team and dive into doing everything I could, because I felt like there was so much more about the business side of it that I didn't understand. And the world is moving in a... Broadcasting is moving. Australian broadcasting, French and English, and a lot of American is already there. They've already dived into the digital world. They're already digital audio broadcasting. They're already doing way more visual stuff. And you could argue that Triple J really inspired a lot of the Western Europe thought process on how they were going to do more live streaming, for example, many, many years ago, over a decade ago when they first started doing that. But it's for me, I felt, having gone through these meetings every year of, here's where the future's going, and you've got this 70-year-old man telling you not to worry about streaming or podcasts or this, that, and the other. And I'm like, I don't know if I'm singing from the same hymn sheet here, dude. And so for me, it wasn't necessarily that I felt I could do it better. It was that, what do I not know? What have I not learned? And so I think so brilliant about what you've done is that you're just, with What Reality Records, you're learning every day that it's a record company. And it's only going to put you in better stead moving forward for whether that doesn't work and you join someone else, or you co-sign and do two things independent, and or whatever it might be.
Yeah. Oh, cheers. No, I think it's nice. It's cool to talk to yourself when you're like comparing it to like the radio industry and how you've sort of done the same thing, or like the independent sort of side. Like, you work at your own pace. So if you were working for someone else, there's like, you kind of don't want to go there. It's like, there's some sort of mental thing where you like intrinsically want to work for yourself, because you've got to further yourself. So every day that I have off, I'm like, I've literally, all I've got myself to blame. I haven't done any, I haven't worked for myself that day. So it's like, sometimes I'm just here every morning, just like, all right, let's write a song. Even if it's shit, just get it out, get the shit ideas out. Maybe like 20 seconds of some part, or this part or that part. But if you don't, I don't know. I think if we maybe were on a label or like on a big thing, they're like, here's your $1 million, now write us two records over the space of 4 years. You'd probably be like, all right, we're going to Barbados for like 6 months of that. And then, I don't know. It's nice that you're still eating the same sort of noodle soup. Like, but like, we're doing better than we were, but it's still like, it's, the music is still, it's not a job. It's like trying to create something that you enjoy, and hopefully. It's still weird that people listen to it. I find that is the hardest part. Like, do you share your content and almost like, I wonder who actually is kind of like, or what target audience I've become? I suppose like, you don't get a gig where you get like 500 people in a room, you actually put a face to like.
Yeah, it's trippy. Well, I mean, there's a two-prong reason why I'm doing this. I've been in bands for years, and I was in a band that sadly broke up due to just a mental health issue, and that person is still alive, thankfully. But we'd been working for several years, and out of all the bands I've been in since, I remember when I was like 15 years old and getting in a van, a plume of smoke opens in the door, and my parents are like, oh God, why are you doing? Well, you always, I'm playing trumpet in this new ska band, mum. Tough shit. You said you want me to play trumpet? Well, I found a band. They just happen to be 30 years older than me and smoke a shit ton of weed, but I'm going to go and jam with them this weekend, and I'll see you on Sunday night. Through that, through the metal and the punk and the rock and everything in between. But with that band, you know, we were right on. We were talking with some labels and stuff like that, and that was quite mind-blowing for me. And we'd spent our 3-4 years here building, going through the smaller venues and building up. And that's why, when you said earlier, like getting that Saturday night, like the moment that we were allowed to have the Friday night, we nearly shit ourselves, but it was an early show though. We had to be done by 9:35. So it was like, oh, we're getting there. But that's sort of another big reason that galvanized this, is that I was ready to go. I was ready to be like, oh shit, there's nothing in my pockets. Just a load of passion. Let's go. And so I think that's part of the, that's exactly why I adore what you do is the fact that you just said, I don't really know why anyone connects with it, because you're not overthinking it, right? Your process seems to be that you just sit down and create. And as you just said, you might find a 20-second nugget here and switch it into something else. But I watched this great interview and I did just shut all my my bookmarks before you joined up. But you spoke with this wonderful fellow who I think was German in April of 2021. And you had said to him that, well, you know, we got back off the other tour and the manager said, I want a new record. And you were like, oh, Jesus Christ, let me just get home and ground a bit first, figure it out. And that became the Sunlight Mound. So what is your process? You just sit down and you don't really think about it too often. And I know that with this album, my closing point here to throw to you, that you're addressing much of what you saw on the road on that tour and just, holy shit, we were in all these places and oh my God, what the hell did we do? So what do you do when you sit down to create? How do you start that process?
I think like if I could just show you, you're on the computer at the moment. If I was on a laptop, I'd show you my little studio. So it's just like, there's guitars all down here and amps and bits and pieces. And so this room has become my writing den. But I used to have like the old house I lived in with another band called Great Gable. And so Alex from that. But that room was like real nice high ceilings. I'm sort of living in a more modern townhouse at the moment with no real view, but I had a little smoking area and a drinking section. And it was like this old balcony. It's like probably built in the 1920s, sort of 100-year-old house. Like real nice, like that colloquial Australian kind of style where it's just like bungalows, if you know what I mean, with a veranda going around the whole thing. And it was like, I think that was so inspiring. Every morning there'd be like some weird bird that's like flown in and that's just like the neighbor's cat. But it was a real quiet street with all these trees. But now I think the writing process is more like, I definitely will just come downstairs, fiddle about on a guitar or whatever. Usually this little bastard is the old jazz master. But some guy came around yesterday who was a painter and he was doing some quotes. And he was like, what have you got here? And he was like, yeah, I've been playing in bands for years. Like, it must have been about 60 or whatever. He's picking everything up. He was like, oh, if you want to sell this, you want to sell this. And he was trying to get me to, like, look at his band from 30 years ago. I was like, dude, I love that. It's like, he didn't even look at it in the house. Like, he was just, like, I came in here and then he asked me to give me $800 for my bass. So I was like, man, that thing's been with me forever. Like, but I don't know. It's usually just trying to get something that I haven't heard before or something that I'm kind of listening to. Like the other day, it was probably a good example. I was listening to Calvin Harris, of all people, his first record. And I think it was that 80s, was it? The one, was it?
Something I got about, except, love for you if you were born in the 80s. The 80s.
But real straight beat that. And I was like, man, that's been in my head and I don't know what it was. And then my girlfriend, she was just like, no, it goes like this. So I was like, acceptable in the 80s or something. Anyway, I was pronouncing it wrong. And so I was like, all right, I'm going to record Calvin Harris's track with it. Do it the way that I want to do it. And then it went from there and it changed into a different part. And then I was like, I'll swap like the kick for some guitars or whatever. And then it sort of became this different song, but it just used that sort of grounding bedwork of his beat. So there was nothing there that's like, it wasn't like tracing it and being like his sample and his this. It was like, all right, I just really like that rhythm, so I was like, just gonna go with that and see what comes up. And then probably made something. I sent it to our manager and he was like, this is sick. So I was like, all right, cool, hopefully it's not the next single, because it's just like, it was a kind of a joke track, but he likes everything but that is kind of, I suppose, a bit more radio accessible. So I think the last couple of records, because I've been having Murray as like my person of what is good or not, rather than sort of maybe a few other people. Like, yeah, even though he's got great taste, he like pretty much discovered Royal Blood, so everything's sort of been slowly going around like a bit more of that kind of style of songwriting, where it's like, all right, I think we can reach more people this way. But I was like, maybe we should just go back and just be like, not care about it. But like you said, it's hard not to think about it sometimes, because you do just want to just sort of sit down and just write whatever. But then the amount of songs you write, yeah, I don't even know what's good, what's bad. Like, and if it was a collection of songs that I've been writing for the year, the album would be about 60 tracks long. So it's like, I think, yeah, someone's got to pick their favorite fits. Maybe I'll send it to you, John. I'll be like, here's the shortlist for the next record. You choose.
Absolutely. You would have my full respect and trust to not leak that to anyone. But let's keep working on our friendship first. But I appreciate the even the joke of that is making me very, very excited and happy. Thank you. But is Murray the manager then? That's Manager Murray. Is that what you mean?
Yeah,
just to clarify. Well, and what do you mean by discovered royal blood? When they were way back, when Mike was over in Australia on work on the holiday, way back when, or in England?
Was that their first manager or something? Well, I know he's been managing for a long time with them at Wildlife. So, yeah, when Mike was in Australia, I think he came back and met Ben in Brighton.
Yeah.
But Murray was with them from that, the first single and their first video clip and their first tours and stuff. So, because we went on tour with it, that's how we sort of met. We got asked to do the Royal Blood show, probably the first big show we've ever done. I think that we've done a couple of festivals, smaller festivals, but then Royal Blood hit us up and it's like, I think that was back in 2017 maybe or 2018. And they came and did a Horton Pavilion and these big rooms. They were 4,000 cap, like Nirvana had played the Horton. It was it's such a big room. I think they had the first big day out in this pavilion. And it was amazing. And then we just got friendly with the boys and then friendly with Murray, and then we didn't have a manager at the time. So it was perfect timing for us to sort of be and he liked what we're doing. We sort of took off together. And now he's over here. He's living in Australia.
Oh, well, there you go. Well, I think it's safe to say that you've got a great fella in your corner, for goodness sake. He's got a great ear. And to speak to your point as well about the difficult in the nuance of how far over the line you step into commercialism or accessibility.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had this discussion with many, many bands. I've been very fortunate to do so over the last decade. And it always irks me when I sense from a band they're more writing from a standpoint of outer body than where it's coming from to begin with. That's my biggest concern. But I think at the same time, you can still dive into that realm and play with it, because it's only if it brings you more tools and more growth, then that's great.
Yeah, I think there's definitely a couple of bits and pieces. Like Bubblegum Infinite is probably a good example of that. I think that was a song I still love it. But I think the idea when it was the riff and everything was off a longer song. And I was like, I think it was about 6 or 7 minutes of this track I loved. And it slowly went into about 3 minutes. And then it went down to I think it's 2:50 or whatever the time is now, of something so compressed into a bite-sized kind of Porn Crumpets digestible, that it's sort of lost a bit of its flavor of where it was going and how it travels. So as much as I still really like the song, it was more to be I think people will understand this easier in this structure. Whereas I remember watching a really good interview with someone talking about how it was a director. It might have been John Villeneuve or whatever his name, Denny Villeneuve. How you can't underestimate the audience. They're smart. It's so you dumbing things down, or not dumbing them down, but trying to think people won't get this. It's exactly who you're going to end up with. So if you're sort of all right, I'll leave it the way it is, and all the little quirks and nuances that you kind of appreciate, it's probably what someone else is going to appreciate too. So I think we've definitely been, I know myself, taking things out, which I'm if I don't really get it, maybe I'll leave it in. But then I suppose you could go even further than that and you end up Black MIDI and just be we're leaving everything.
So. Yeah, this is going to be 11 minutes and 37 seconds and you ain't changing shit.
Exactly. But it's still enjoyable. It's kind of there's a really nice balance between that and sort of, I suppose, where we would like to sit and also have fun, but also sort of just know that what you're doing isn't fucking garbage. It's it's not just, you're not just trying to make music to sell music. It's this is what we're feeling. This is our version of lockdown in sonic form or what we're going through. So, yeah, it'd be nice to just go and live in some beach hut or do a Bon Iver, just go off into the wilderness and be here's my heart. And that album is so beautiful.
Yeah.
It was almost a joke kind of when it came out, but I listened to it recently and I was man, that's real.
It's really special. I remember when it first came out and got sent through to the radio station and I was this is a really interesting thing to send through to a modern rock station. But I think it was more just from the artist, just the composition artistry is what I was trying to say there, that was so groundbreaking and interesting. Yeah. Your answer, before I forget, reminded me of Found God in the Tomato, because that's almost yeah. like four songs in one, but you left that as it was. But I mean, that's 5 years back. That's 5 years back.
Yeah.
Such a great jam, man.
Cheers. Yeah, so that's always been the that first record, because it was every song that I probably wrote. It was the best 10 songs I think I had out of the 5 years or whatever I've been sort of doing the rock music kind of thing. So it was like, and everything that did maybe work in another band, you know, just saved. And then obviously the second one was the what you've been writing at the time. I think, yeah, there's now, it's like, I'd love to just sort of clear the B-sides out and just be like, all right, starting again. I think we're sort of at that point now, but there's always going to be a little thing you're like, oh, I know it's kind of good, but it's like, it's not, I don't know. Maybe a B-sides cleanse is what you need. You know, we can just be like, you clear your iTunes, you clear your debt, your cache is empty, just like, here, everyone, here's a bunch of stuff, I'm just going to start again. Because you always eventually, like, you might be drunk, or you might be in a different mind, or you might listen to the song that you didn't put on the last record, but for some reason it's good enough to go on with one afterwards.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't know. It's a strange thing like that.
Yeah, sometimes the energies just work that way. But are you talking in a sense of strike the B-sides from the live set, or just strike them from streaming and they're gone, and if you've got physical, that's it, enjoy it? What do you mean by that?
Oh, no, like as in, I think just releasing them now, just so I'm saying release them from...
Oh, you get them out separate ahead of the record, you mean?
Yeah.
Right. See, I went a far more macabre way than what I thought you meant for a second. Fucking burn them all, Jack. They're dead to me.
Nah. That'd be a nice way to sort of, if you could sort of show people the record before the record, and it was like a band, like, or a fan vote or something, and you're just like, everyone put together, like, in whatever track listing they want, and we'll release this in, I don't know, 2 months' time. So everyone has the short list of 30 tracks or whatever. And then they go, I think this should be on the album, this should be on the album. And they can keep the spare 20 tracks if they want, but it's like, there's some, I feel like that would be a nicer way to connect with the audience rather than us trying to decide. Because it's not, we don't get the pleasure out of it anymore. If they listen, it's kind of like, it's up to fans, I suppose, at that point, or people who are listening.
Yeah, that I think that'd be really cool. I mean, that sounds very Radiohead world and realm of just... But I think
everything. I want everything on that record.
Yeah, I have way too much Radiohead stuff in this house. But that's more of a, I don't know. That almost feels like I'm bragging at this point. Sorry, I didn't mean to be bragging.
Nah, it's not bragging at all. I had the, what do you call it? I was listening to, I think I've listened to Kid A more than I've listened to any other record ever, and I got really sad. Like, it was about 2 days ago, I think. I had it on in the car and I was like, I wish this could fucking hit me the same way it did. I listened to this like the fourth or fifth time. Like, the first listen was kind of confusing. I was like, what is this music? And then it was like probably about fourth listen, I was like, I fucking love this record. Like, and I think I've had it on the other day. It's like, I can just, my brain is so, as I think, I know what's going to come and you know what's going to happen, but you just feel like, give me the old Eternal Sunshine treatment. I want to erase records so I can listen to them again.
Yeah, that was something that used to trip me out a lot as a kid, is I would lie in bed at night and be like, oh my God, I'm going to die. I'm going to die one day. And you know, when you go through all the ways you're going to die. But then what I found myself doing in my mid-30s is going, oh my God, I can't remember any of these incredible moments of my youth. I can't remember anything. I can't remember, like Alex, I was talking to my best friend the other day, and he was going, oh, I remember when we did this when we were 17 years old. And I was like, no, I don't fucking remember any of that at all. I don't know. But what some of the only things, though, Jack, that I do recall is when there's music involved, because the way that my mind works with music is it analyzes the shit out of it. Like when I listen to your music, it will be, okay, here's my first time play of Dread and Butter or whatever it might be. And then I'll come back to it when I'm in different moods, happy, sad, in between, exhausted, elated, whatever. And then I start going through, after about 10 or 12 listens, each layer of the production, each instrument, each line, each backing vocal, everything. And then I go through it again, and I go whether I'm happy, sad, or other emotions in between, because there are so many, especially with the way that you write, which I think I said whimsical earlier, and just so conversational. And it's like, we're just, you know, I feel like I'm in the van with you, and you're like, shit, are we in Turkey? Fuck, I think we're, what? Oh man, this is great, but we got to go and get this show in. I just feel like we're there, you know, walking down the next morning, like, oh Jesus Christ. And that's what music does. And that's why I cling on to it, is when it transports me there, then I'm pretty sure I can get back in that car. Now, it's not going to be, as we're discussing, the exact same emotion as it was when 17, 18, 19, 20, but a cousin of at least.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, my old girlfriend's calling. I think I'll send her a message. I'll just say I'm doing an interview.
That's okay.
Sorry.
No, gosh, no need to be sorry at all, man.
She got my car, so it's over the pit, so it's probably going to, it's either going to be like they're going to have to demolish it, or it's going to cost $10,000 to get it fixed. So,
oh, Jesus.
What do you call one of those?
But is it okay, whilst you text that, is it okay to play a little bit of Dread and Butter?
Yeah, of course.
All right, because I think this is... Listen to your own voice for a few minutes here. Just because I feel the first five lines fit exactly where what we're talking about right now. Seconds. I know you've heard this 5,000 times. Right, so we've got a taste for the first minute. We're going to skip it in another minute. Because I love these strings coming in here. Get the brush sticks out. The sarcastic asshole in me wants to say, where did the all riff boys go? This is absolutely stunning. It's just so beautiful.
It is.
The composition, because I found your old SoundCloud account that's not very private. You've not shut it down. Yeah, unless you're not aware of that, right? Harbinger Lilt.
What, as in my sound? Oh, did you? Fuck, is that still going?
That's still live, mate. Yeah.
Right.
And so I could just, you know, I'll link it to you if you want to get in there and reaccess and shut it down afterwards. But I've been listening through to your progression as a composer the last 10 years, and you've got to sit there, as much as it might be awkward, and go, man, this is fucking brilliant how far you've come. And this is just so stunning. It's just so beautiful. Talk us a little bit about Dread and Butter, because I think, again, lyrically, it's full of your character that I adore. And is so witty and grounded. And then musically, sonically, it's just so lush. And you've said in all these gearing up for the Night Known record, you've said, well, we'll get a bit metal, we'll get a bit Sabbath, and we'll get a little bit beautiful. And I wasn't expecting it to be like this. It's amazing.
Oh, thank you very much. I think it literally, Dread and Butter sort of stems from exactly that conversation you had with your mate Alex about not being able to remember, like, fuck all. You sort of, I think I had a similar thing with a couple of friends, and the girlfriend now, she has the best memory ever. And so I was like, I'm kind of intimidated by her memory. Like every holiday she's been on, she'll just remember, like, I was there, I did this, stayed up till 3, and then we went out. I was like, man, like, the last 2 years of my head are blanks. I remember you, I love you, but today I don't know what. It's like, so I think it was that, me trying to remember childhood, and I was like, all right, what do I remember? And I remember like building forts up the woods or something, like, because I grew up in England as well, just outside of Milton Keynes, and like Woburn Sands. So it was really nice. It was like sort of little country lanes that would just be connected by like tractors going to the pub, like, and then you just have like woodlands in between. So like building bracken forts and getting cuts and bruises and a bit like putting conkers and vinegar in the fridge and doing like conker battles and stuff.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Sort of, And then just smelling like saw bling, because you just like get cuts all over yourself. So it was sort of like, I was like, all right, that's sort of kind of remember. And it was, and then afterwards you're just churning your head because you're thinking too much about why I'm not thinking. So it was all like that kind of dread. And I thought it, dread butters kind of like, I don't know, it sounded nice, rolled off the tongue easy. And it sort of went together. And I think the riff is a little play on Hats Off to the Green Bin. So that it's the same, I think it's the same guitar structure. So I don't know if you can hear it, but you got that. It's in the wrong key. I'll get the old acoustic. Where is it? I've lost my guitar.
Is that one drop to B or what?
It's just standard or standard drop D, but as in the whole thing's...
Oh, just the interview I watched before I chat with you, you were talking about drop B a lot, and I was like, oh, okay. I'll smuggle that in.
So that... The Hats Off to the Green Bins was that kind of like... got that last note on that sort of C kind of thing. I don't know, but then I just used the chorus in Dread and Butter because I was like, oh, that's like, it's just so nice with the string sort of on top of it. You got like, just like one of those lazy kind of songs, you know, when you just like, I don't want to move my hands a lot, but it kind of feels nice. I can imagine like a, I don't know, a lot of those slower Metallica ones. What's that one? Was like, dun, 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 dun. He must have just been on his belly, just like. Didn't want to move a hand at all. It's like, all right, that's how that song goes. But they sort of somehow feel a lot. They've got that kind of lazy vibe to it. And then if you do just put some drums or a bit of some strings and sort of build it, like Radiohead do that amazingly.
Yeah.
Like, it feels like it's no effort to listen to it. Especially the newer record they did, the Moonshaped Pool, like that Daydreaming song, where it's like there are the way the piano changes from going from clean to then it's like some Leslie kind of vibe. And then you've got that, well, it's a thing going on as well. Like you, it took me about 8 lessons before I sort of picked up on it. They're like, oh, that piano is like not the same piano. It's just constantly changing and changing. And I think that's something that they've worked on. And obviously they're not allowed to be a band. They've got fucking Johnny Greenwood, who's like arguably one of the best modern composers
on
ever.
The planet. Yeah.
Yeah, his film scores and everything. Like, yeah, he's nuts. He's the BBC's golden child. They're just like, all right, we'll get Johnny on it. Like, he'll just make whatever Attenborough's done in the last 30 years to just be
huge. Yeah. Just him, just Johnny and David in a room together going, in a battle to survive, over and over and over and over again.
Yeah.
Johnny, I need something that's like a battle to survive. Okay, I got you. Yeah. We're good. But you usually everything is made predominantly. It's all you in that room for the most part, right? With Shiger, is that the situation with Gnome coming up or not?
Yeah, like I think it's only because a lot of the time, like it happened on the first couple of records where I'd save the idea. I think I wasn't as good at recording back then. Like I'm not even that good at recording now, but I sort of at least get it to a more finished position in my head. Like, or if I'm sitting here rather than fleshing the whole song out on a guitar and then going into a jam room and trying to work it with the boys and stuff. It feels like you're saving 3 months worth of work if I can do that in a day here, where I'm like, the drum's done, the guitar's done, the bass's done, sort of vocal pattern ideas and the violins and things. So I don't know. And then I spend the next 3 months tweaking bits and pieces because I suppose that's where maybe the confusion or some of the confusion a lot of the songwriting comes from. Maybe you're just like, how is it there? Where have we gone from this part and that part? But because I'm maybe a bit bored of listening to the original, that I've gone, let's just fuck it up purposefully and try and change bits and pieces. And then all the weird little guitars that are in Shiger come in. So I'm like, I think I've got to sort of go back to Shiger. I love the little tweaks and sort of the blah, blah, blah. I don't even know what they call that, the glitch out guitar kind of transpose things that are real high. But it sort of got a bit confusing, a bit messy with the compression, I think. So it almost would have worked as like a cleaner record in some parts, but I think that was just because I thought about it for way too long. So there's a classic example of overthinking. So I think now I'm getting to the point where it's like, I need to work. If I'm working on a song, I can't give it more than 2 days before I have to work on something else. Else I'll scrap it. And I think I've been doing that so much now that I'll be like, the whole week I'll work on 5 minutes of music and I'm just like progressively feeling more enthused about it. And I'll go to the pub and be like, man, the damn work. And I'm talking like to a different couple of friends or whatever. Showing my girlfriend, I'm like sitting down here and the speakers are going, she's like, oh, I think this would be a good one. I think you'd be all right. And then by Friday, you like feel like a dick because you just scrapped it all and you're just like, man, it was useless. Like, why do you even think it was good? Yeah. So I've just used that and repeat. And then going back through what I sort of created maybe a couple of months ago, I'm like, oh, there's something in here actually. So I've completely forgotten about how I even record it, what instruments are on there. It's sort of the idea itself is kind of just the thing you take in. So yeah. I think that's where I'm sort of at the moment with songwriting, not knowing anything.
And so with that and with what you were talking about in some of the B-sides earlier, which we've now since realised, mainly me being the issue that didn't understand that you were saying about getting ahead maybe of a record, do you ever consider writing like a part two or a response to a song or even completely reimagining and recording a song that you felt, do you know what, I do feel now a few years later, I want to flip reverse that?
Oh, I'd love to. I think I'd absolutely love to, but there's that thing where I remember there was a band called, the Mystery Jets, and they had this EP that was on SoundCloud, which I thought was the best, most lo-fi. It sounded like it was recorded with a potato on a couple of like Nokias. It was like awful, but it absolutely slapped. It was the heaviest thing. And I was like, I loved it. And I think they then took all their songs that they'd put out on SoundCloud and released the record where they produced it and went and recorded with someone actually quite it was called Before My Own was the song. If you can find the original of that song to what they eventually recorded it as, it was really clean and I was like, no, like that's what I loved. So I think once you've listened to something, that's how it is forever. Do you know what I mean? It's like you can't really, even when you listen to, I think there was the band Band of Skulls, they had three or four different versions of Hoochie Coochie that came on the radio.
Yeah, they did.
And I was like, this song's amazing. And then when I went to listen to it, I was like, this isn't it. And I was like, it is it, but it's not it. It's like, and I was trying to find the one out with the riff at the end. I've still never found it, but it was, I think that pissed me off rather than it did anything. I was like, you can't change it once it's done.
So with Band of Skulls, and I've known Russell and Emma from being in broadcasting for a decade, and this is not a regular conversation thing. It's just like whenever they're in town, it's like, hey, what's up? Because when I moved to Canada, and they're from Southampton, when I moved in the south of England, for those that don't know, when I moved here, one of the first bands that my boss, former boss, Canadian dad said to me, you must know Band of Skulls, right? I was like, I don't. He's like, you're from fucking England. I just hired you to work at my really exciting modern rock station. You don't know who this band is. We're the only station in Canada playing this band. They're going to be the next biggest rock band on the planet. And I was like, okay, I'll look into it. And yes, unbelievable, unbelievable. But then from getting to know them across those 5, 6, 7 years, and because we were the only rock station playing, and we did loads of meet and greets and shows, and they played all the major festivals on the island here, and they're just so good. But we spoke with them at length about, okay, well, what is your release plan in Australia compared to Europe, compared to North America, compared just between Canada and the US? And this is one of the things that really bums me out about the industry, is that you don't necessarily have to obtain success in one bubble of the music world to survive off your art keep going. But then there's that pressure, depending on who you might work with or who you might meet along the way, that says, well, I think we've got to try this in this market, this in this market. And that's when it becomes a bit too much chop and change for me. It takes away from the soul a bit.
Exactly. I think as well, when you know it's coming from the source, like there was a band, who was it? Oh yeah, Hiatus Coyote. Like their first couple of records when they put them out, I think they still release it on their Bandcamp. But anyway, two absolutely unbelievable records, but you'd always just be going over to their whatever, SoundCloud, just seeing what they were coming up with, and then released snippets, and then I think Bone Tomahawk came out, and then they released that Choose a Weapon. And now they're with Brain Feeder, which is Flying Lotus's record label. So they're doing But it was cool. Like, their progression of it was like, you would go to the source, but now Brain Feeder is the only people that I would like them to be in the hands of, because just like, they get music and they're all like 1,000 years more advanced than any of us. So I don't know, they've got a time machine somehow. But and yeah, they're just exploiting us mere millennials. I don't know. What would we be called as a group? Maybe it would all be millennials, maybe. I don't know. But yeah.
So do you feel then, to dig deeper into that question 10 minutes back, that you would approach a sort of blockage of self-intrigue, which is, oh, I kind of want to reimagine these songs, but maybe the audience doesn't fucking want them touched?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. I think that's definitely the way I would answer that question. But if it was just for me, I think, yeah, I would, oh man, I'd take everything down and redo it for like, and hear that better. And then, you know, someone would be like, man, bro, I liked it before. But, and then you would have the argument, but it's way better now. And they'd be like, no, it wasn't, it's missing this, it's missing that. And so I suppose what you're finding enjoyment out of, I find the enjoyment of now just fucking polishing the shit out of anything. Just be like, and that's how a guitar should sound, rather than people not, I don't know, like, every time I watch a movie, I'm not like, oh, the color grading on this. I sometimes, I don't know. It usually goes, like, I don't know why I liked Dune, but it was cool. I was like, I mean, probably going to bits and pieces, but there's like, it isn't, I don't know. There's so many people who listen to music, but I don't, if it was someone who was listening for the production, I suppose yourself, what you said, and then that kind of stuff, I would like to try and get better. But then I suppose just the person who's listening to it, how do you, I don't know. Now I'm going existential.
I've sent you on a crisis here. Yeah. I started this conversation saying how much I love that you didn't overthink it. And I seem to have put you in a spot of complete fucking overthink doom. Sorry, man.
You're all good.
There's no, yeah. The thing is with me is that this is the other thing that I love about not being a commercial radio is you're not under pressure to give me anything at all that you don't want to. If an answer doesn't appear, if a thought doesn't appear, it's fine, we move on. I just love conversing and getting to know people, so there's no, I'm not looking for a soundbite, basically, Jack. Yeah, it's all good.
You're all good. I think I'm just looking for words, that's it.
But let's listen to a little bit of Bubblegum Infinity. We'll do the first 30 seconds. Such a good transition there. And that's where I'm going to pause it for now, because something that I don't know if you, I'm intrigued. So I'm going to put to you what I think instead of putting words in your mouth. One thing that fascinates me about your vocal style is the elongation of words. Now, it's not to the point that you notice like, oh, he's really hanging on this word longer than usual, but you subtly, it seems to be your trademark. I don't know if I'm hitting a chord, striking a chord here or not, but usually you would expect some of your phrases to be done. Like if you're going 1, 2, 3, 4, and just following that tempo of that song, you expect to be wrapped about 3 or 4 beats before you do. I like that you elongate the lines into the next step of the composition of the song. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, I suppose I've never even thought about it. I think that's something that maybe there was definitely a part, there was a whole different verse that we had for that song, and Rish was like, man, you can't release that, like, I will not play in the band, I will not play that song ever.
Oh,
I think it's like how Rish, like Luke, the guitarist, he's like definitely not a fan of this track. But I think it's because the idea was like we had this Sabbath-y kind of vibe, and then it was going to be all big and heavy. And then I think I just had that acoustic thing, but it was supposed to be like to show everyone that moment it hits from the acoustic into the big thing. Like, I just thought that working through festival speakers and got a big synth sub, it's just like his, what it went through from like a 50s recording to sort of like a bit more modern where the things open up and it sounds like the radio is transitioning. So you've got that sort of production stuff. And it was like a nice way of showing everyone this, like, we've achieved this. Even though it's crispy as fuck, it would be nice if there was a part of the song which opens up even more at the end, which is like, all right, it's like, but yeah, like the production itself is stepping up. But I just thought that would absolutely slap through some festival speakers. So going back to what I was saying, the verse though, it was originally like something, oh man, I can't remember. Something about sitting, finding your legs, the old classic porn crumpets. Maybe I was holding onto legs. Legs! No, I don't know. But it was a... I think, yeah, I've never thought about it before.
Well, it stands out. I don't want to dive back too far after we're focusing on night gnomes, but with Mango, with Tripol, and with Sawtooth, it's noticeable there as well, where you just... Again, this isn't a negative thing. It's just what stands out to me. Just very, very different, very tiny, minute differences between other deliveries, and it just flows over into the next. It's like when you've got a typewriter and you're slapping it back, right? But you don't hear the ka-ching, and you're still going as it's being reset. If that makes sense, like a second to a second and a half longer than maybe if I was singing it following a basic tempo of what the song structure is. But maybe it gives it more of a conversation feel. It's like we're back in that house that you were describing earlier that inspired some earlier music, where you've got your little smoking pit in your beer cocktail lounge or whatever. You can just chill out in the circle and do it. It's just that more, there's no rush to our journey, man. We're going to get there. Come with me. That's what I like about the way you share lyrics. Oh, you're frozen.
Thank you. I like that. I really like that analogy. That's probably the most in-depth. Am I back?
Yes, sorry.
You're all good. No, I said that's a real beautiful analogy. I think you've actually thought about it. It's nice having a conversation with. I feel like, I don't know, you're like my music guru right now. You're like, Jack, this is how you should change the music.
You don't fucking change shit that I tell you. I'm just going to tell you what I really like about things, and that's one of them. Let's listen to a little bit more Bubblegum so I don't lose track of this point now. Skip into around the bridge area here is. Skip beyond the last chorus there, didn't I? What are you running vocals through there? Three things? Or at least the tubes you put on post. What are you?
What was I running through? It's either this. I had a Singstar mic for ages, so I just literally had this shitty dynamic. I think I was about $5 from Cash Converters, but I've now gone up to the old condenser. And I'm like, should start recording them clearer and cleaner. Because everything beforehand was going through the same vocal pack. Like basically guitar thing that I had, like guitar rig, the vocals were going through the same amp as the guitar. So everything was all in the same sort of frequency for Shiger and that, a lot of bits and pieces. So in Night Gnomes, I was like, oh, I actually need to change it. I think Bubblegum was one of the older tracks. So there's a few songs like Slinky and a track, The Terminus, the creative sort of opening track where you can sort of really hear the clarity kind of come out a bit more now, because I've just gone, maybe I shouldn't sing through the same guitar amp that I'm playing guitar through. Like, it's going to clash a bit. So I'm starting, but that's taken me 5 years to learn. I think in another 5 years, eventually you get to the point where it's like, all right, you can release a record where you're like, if you want to purposely fuck it up, you can purposely fuck it up, but you need to know how to make it clear and big first. Before, because I think that's it. Everything's trial and error at the moment. I'm like, what could sound good? And when people are like, oh, go, you should write another song like I don't know, Cornflake or Cubensis. I was like, I don't even know how. Like, I don't know what was going on back there. So we were just taking a fuckload of mushrooms. So maybe we should do that. I was like, you know, when you kind of think a bit about what you're doing and if you like where you're going to go. I always know, like, I think if I thought that we've wrote the best music, I wouldn't be trying to create music anymore, but I'll go do something else. I think we're still fighting to be like, I want to release the best thing we could possibly do. And it's almost like as soon as I release a record, there's no satisfaction in it because you're just like, oh, I know I can do better. All right, start again. All right, and then you start going back and you're like, oh, I'm on the sixth one. And then you're like, once that's sort of nearly finished, you're like, all right, I still think I could do way better. I don't think there's ever going to be any of that, like, sort of we did it kind of moment. But that's kind of what makes it fun. I think starting from that complete blank canvas is one of the – it's I don't know. There's something about it, just looking at a white – I'd love to go to a museum and just see a bunch of white canvases. It would make me – it would probably give me more inspiration than seeing a bunch of art. You're like, oh, we could put this here and do that. It's like that's just being clean. Maybe we release 10 tracks with no names, no music, and it's all on record, though, and just put it out. It's got no – it's a white album cover. Like, here it is, Porn Crumpets, untitled.
Well, heard it here first. That's I'm not sure if your boss is going to be into that too much, but yeah, no. But that's a great analogy, though. I like that. I've never heard that before. Going into a hotel, not a hotel. I prefer if a lot of hotels would take down their shit artwork too. But no, as if I stay in them like some grand lord. Like, no, come on. All I do is stay in hotels. I've not got time for these houses you speak of. I like that, though, going in and giving you the chance, because actually that's what I've been really wanted to dive into and speak to you about, is when I did my best of 2021 and I wrote about 111 different bands, I sat down and was like, okay, what are the songs in the bands that have spoken to me and galvanized my soul this year? I don't like to look through, and I've done this whether I was in commercial radio or not, for like top 10 albums of the year and top 20 singles of the year and stuff that we did when I was in that realm. But I like to just, I don't want to be, oh, what was the Spotify and what was my Bandcamp purchases and what did I do that? What comes to mind? Because it hit here. And so initially when I'd written about yours, I'd spoken about how when Alex and I, my best friend and a few of others of us went to Amsterdam, and this is when I was, I want to say, I don't know, 19 or between 19 and 21. Memories from way back when, as we were talking about forgetting some of them. This is certainly some of these memories I don't recall, but a lot of them I do. And I'd written in my little write-up about Lava Lamp that, you know, 20 years back-ish, I was in Amsterdam taking mushrooms, and I swear I pissed in Flipper the Dolphin's head instead of the toilet. And that's all I really saw for a split second. What we had bought was more of a happy-go-lucky rather than a visual trip. Basically said, you know, meanwhile, on the other side of the planet, several years later, a group of guys are doing something similar. I'm not sure. Because what I'd read on your website and seen here and there was, okay, university project or going to the farm or taking shrooms. And, you know, I know a lot of bands, and CJ has asked here in the chat, where did the name come from? I know when I've spoken to some bands in the past, I'm not going to name drop, they have a set of stories. How would you want to position yourself today to address the starting of this band and the name choice, if you wish to?
I think just being morons. I think that was it. I think we had no intention of ever being successful, or it was just a piss take, I think. And I think I liked that. We were originally wanting to be like a bit more of a punk band. So like the Psychedelic Porn Crumpets was just taking the piss out of all the sort of these psych bands that were coming out of Perth at the time. And we were just like, oh, Psychedelic Porn Crumpets. And everyone was like, oh, they kind of beat us to the joke beforehand, I think. And now, because psych music is sort of, I suppose it's not as, it's still huge. Like, you've got bands like the Lazy Eyes, Gizzard, and like there's some great bands coming out like now. Not the Gizzard are coming out now, but like, I think going forward, it was like that kind of punk mentality, I suppose. And then the rest of the world sort of caught up. And then you go to Europe and it's like, it feels like they're, like, I remember some guy in Italy, I did an interview with some guy in Italy. It's like, oh, like, have you, I'm just listening to Tame Impala, and he was listening to Porn Crumpets, and he's like, I can't like some of these songs, it's great. But he hadn't heard King Gizzard. I was like, it's the rare moment that we surpassed Giz and they've discovered us first. And we were like, oh my God, like, if we could just do that, like, we're going to be big in Italy, boys. So,
yeah. We're going to be mammoth.
It's nice, though. I still think there's a carefree sort of attitude towards it, hence the sort of titles of the song names. And I think that sort of makes me feel a little bit safer about releasing anything. Like, definitely sometimes overthink it and do think, like, what are people going to think? But I think if you just, like, we're a band called Psychedelic Porn Crumpets, it's already sort of just a bit of a scramble and a bit of a mess and a bit of all these sort of, like, mushroom and acid adventures that we used to sort of, indulge in. But now it's sort of become, I don't know.
Well, on the website about me, it changed to Prawn Crumpets recently.
Yeah. Was it Psychogenic Prawn Crumpets?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's the, it's weird. It's weird we've managed to carve a career out of our drug dependencies. I think that's it's a bit strange. But now we're all kind of a little bit more sober, which is nice. The occasional big weekend, but I think it's been, maybe we should start doing drugs again. Maybe that's what we need to do.
I don't know, man. I didn't want to get you down that road. I mean, I haven't drank in, I think I was saying this earlier in the stream, I think it's over 3 years now since I've drank any alcohol. And I don't do anything. I still smoke marijuana, and mainly more sativas, and I have a very particular palate that I go to and able to make sure that I'm not like unless it's after 11 o'clock at night. I have like my go-to strains for bedtime, and I've got my, you know, afternoon evening strains for getting just to chill out after the show, and just to chill out in general. But that's just not, it's amazing when you start looking back and go, oh my God, like went pretty hell for leather for a little bit there. And then, for me these days, I'm like, I love waking up in the morning and actually feeling alive. It's nice. It's nice not to wake up hungover anymore.
I think that's it. The reason I would probably give up if I've ever would was just because you feel absolutely disgusted the next couple of days. Like, oh man, I had way too many. It seems to be a thing at the moment, but I think, having just a week, I really look forward to the week because I know that I'm not going to have a big one. I think the weekend sort of used to scare me for a while. Like, obviously you'd want to go out and want to sort of be like, let's see what we can do. But there's, I don't know. I feel like as we're getting older, it's like people are like, well, I'm going to have to keep drinking now because I know that I'm not when I'm going to be 35 or something. So we're almost at that slight age where you're like, I know it's going to dwindle down, so you're like, oh, we'll have one more big one. And it's just like every pub session, I think you just enjoy the pub. I think that's it.
That's the hard thing, though. That was one of the hardest things for me when I was stopping is detaching from the circles or the camaraderie or the regulars that you bump into. But then the more and more sober I got, the more I realized that a lot of some of the regulars I hung around with, I really didn't fucking like. Like, I didn't, that's not me, you know? Like, when you sat there and there's insert name here who's 65 years old and he's complaining to the bartender about not being able to put the fucking US Open on. And I'm like, I don't know if I want to gravitate to sit next to this guy anymore now. I guess the 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 or 15 pints before was sort of closing my ear off to this bullshit. I don't want to be here now.
Yeah.
It's probably the most polite example I could use because I don't want to talk bad for anyone that can't discuss their angle with me right now. But it's fascinating. Anyway, Lava Lamp Pisco. Bit of this a second here. Now, what I find really interesting about the production on this song is that it sounds like the band is performing live in an underground tunnel. And it is so perfectly mixed. Everything's in its right place. That obviously that lead guitar riff there is on your right-hand side. Maybe it's about 15-20% to the right. And it just, everything is just in its delicate space, but there's this almost whirlwind tornado sideways feel to it where you're in this circular experience and you're just twirling around constantly. Because I mean, I don't know if I'm guessing right or not, but is there at least 7 layers of guitar in this or what? I mean, it's just constantly,
it'd be far too many, I think. And then that's one of those things where it's like, what's the best version of that track? Like, I think is that that's I think recording wise, like what's different, I suppose what we're trying to do is we don't ever hear it live until the song's finished. It's kind of a strange backwards thing. Like, we'll record the song, we'll finish the song, and then we'll learn to play it live. And so you're actually like, sometimes when you're playing it live, you're like, probably doesn't need like 9 guitars there. It's like, we'll just change that to one part or this part. And then it's almost like, how can we make it clearer? Whereas I suppose a lot of other bands will play their songs like millions of times at shows, and then they go and work out what songs are good. And then when they go into the studio, like, that's the part, this is my one guitar part, and then you mix it. I think I just get so carried away just being like, heavier, heavier, heavier. And it's just like, the only way that I know how is like adding more and more and more until you get this convoluted sort of cathedral kind of sound where yeah. It's just like, yeah, yeah. But some of it is awful when I'm like, when I'm talking with Jelly who's mixing, I'm like, how do we bring all this out? How do we do this? It's like, oh no, you record it again. I'm like, we can't record it again. Like, that's how it goes. It's like, all right. So, and once you listen to it a million times, it sort of like develops in your head as that's how it's sounding. That's how the song is. That's how it goes. So I feel like you listen to a song twice, or like at least I do. It's the day you write it, three times then. The day you finish it and you're happy with it. And then for some reason, the day you put it out, it sounds way different. And you're just like, what? Why did I do that? Like, why is this part there and the guitars and like this? So I suppose it gives it a bit of flavor. That's what people enjoy. So yeah. Am I here?
You're here, but it was one of those things where you were doing this, but we could still hear you. It was like you were just fucking chopping in, chopping into the sentence yourself. Like Leonardo's coming. No, it's. Yeah. I just want to sass myself for a second and say 7 fucking guitar layers, John. You guessed at 7. Okay. I mean, I could have just said a wealth of guitar instead of, I don't know where that came from. End of my day, nearly 9 o'clock at night. Like, I'm going to go with 7 brain lips. Tell him 7. There you go. But let me play another 30 seconds here. But doesn't the way that your songwriting go that you're doing everything first, you'll compose it, you'll play it, and then it's made, isn't it? Then you go, right, no, we need to get the live drums tracked. I was under the understanding that you are everything when it comes to the production side of it at the start. Then you might go out and twist and turn. But when it comes to like Shiger, for example, you didn't really have any opportunity to necessarily go and fart about with that and come back and readjust and do this and that and the other. So that was all you, was it not?
Yeah. I think that's what I'm saying though. Like, I think it's until you show someone else. Like, I think I've been, until you show someone else, then it's sort of like you want to change it. So like, you get comfortable with your own decision. And I sort of do that a lot where I'm like, there was almost no intention to show it anybody. And they're like, oh, fuck, that's right. It's got to go out on a record under the name Psychedelic Porn Crumpets. So I think there's that dawning feeling when you're like, is what you're doing the best way that song can sound? If that's like sort of going back to what I was saying before.
Yeah.
It's like you've only heard it that one way. So it's like, and then when you do start playing it 100 times, you're like, fuck, that's when I'd probably go and record it different. Maybe we could do a live record where it's like all the stuff that we do. It's, I don't know. I have no idea anymore, John.
Are there any differences? I know I'm really stamping down on this point, but are there any differences in how you've gone about making the upcoming record with Night Gnomes compared to Shiger? Have you had the chance to have more lives, you know, have the other guys come in and play parts instead of just all you?
No, I think it should have. I think I got, Rich played a bit of synth on Slinky, and he played drums on Bob Holiday. And then Danny did drums for the rest of the tracks. And I think that was sort of the extent of it. I mean, there was bits and pieces where like the intro song for the Terminus the Creator, it starts off with this really kind of weird, like Hans Zimmery kind of thing. And then it just blasts into the record. Me and Rich spent a bit of time working on that. I think I wouldn't mind just being like going to his and taking the whole file and be like, I swear, what do you want to do with this? Or like, I'm stuck. Maybe I should give him the B-sides. Maybe I should work with the band a bit more. Yeah, I think that would save a lot of thought process. I don't know. I suppose it's like just every song like isn't a Porn Crumpets idea, I suppose. So you're just like, what should it be like? And then if you're writing like some folky music, or it might be doing something that's a bit more, I don't know, Prodigy kind of bass, it's like, or something a bit more sample kind of patched, then it sometimes gets brought over into the Crumpet world. So it'd be nice to sort of just be like, all right, like this is a Crumpets record. And like I said, go away, do the old Log Cabin Bon Iver kind of thing, rather than the house, like in this room. It feels like it could get a bit crowded, claustrophobic with ideas.
Yeah, and just to be clear, I'm not shitting on you here for not involving anyone else. I love what you make. I'm just trying to get into the nuance of the actual, like, every little bit of detail I could soak up from you for this conversation before you get out and hit the world tour. But the last few things, you've given me so much time, I can go on and on and on and on and on, but I'm cognizant of the fact you're starting your day. So let's just check in that you, have you got another, how much longer have you got? I don't want to, your partner's messaging.
For however long we want. All I got to do is just call up the missus at some point, and that's about it. So
okay, I just want to check that. Yeah, whenever you need to be on your phone and let anyone know what the hell's going on, please don't feel rude, just do it. So I thank you for diving into that a bit more, because it's fascinating. Everyone's got their own way of going about it. And it's like even the band that I used to be in, for example, we were just a three piece, but the guitar player, Jordan, we would say to him, you've got an idea in mind. You've got a riff. You've got a beat that you feel is going to meet that, because I would play drums. You've got a beat that you feel is going to go with that. Well, why don't you just quickly compose it, chuck it in Ableton, Cubase, whatever the fuck, bring it over and show it. And he would never do it because he was like, no, that's infringing upon the energy that you're going to bring to it. I'd rather explain it verbally and then you pick up on it. And if you do, you don't. And if you don't, you do, and everything in between. And so everyone's got their own system and style of doing it. And that's only why I asked, to really get into the finite point of that, because ultimately it's really cool. It's like then when you watch things like the KEXP live session, you see, oh, right. So now I've seen and heard what your mind is. Now I get to see how you and your best friend's minds bring it all together. And it adds that little bit extra of intrigue and salt that is just so wonderful. So there's no right or wrong answer to anything I'm asking you. I don't mean to send you down so many flipping channels of torture today.
All good.
Do you want to dive into a bit of this fucking SoundCloud I found of yours or not?
Yeah, you can talk about it. It's the Harbinger Lilt stuff.
Yeah, I just want to verify that this is actually yours.
Yeah, what stuff is it?
You are Jack McEwen from Perth, Australia.
There you go, yeah.
And the last thing you uploaded was 5 years ago, called Riaz. Is that ringing any bells?
Yeah, that's the track. God, I haven't listened to that in... Was that 5 years ago? I had there was like an old Indian Bollywood sample pack that was like on the... what do you call it? What's the archive thing called? The Creative Commons. It was all like from like 50s movies or whatever. I was like, man, that sounds amazing. So I was just messing around, sampling and remixing them, kind of just doing bits and pieces. So
I'm gonna play 15 second sample of it here. Turn it down a bit. We're going down memory lane here. Then the next thing was Namahaya. Is that, am I saying that right? Namahaya?
Yeah, that was just the name of the sample that I had. So
right, that was this. Thought that just came to my mind is you should fucking play some of these before you walk out on stage and no one's gonna know what the hell.
I get some credits. Yeah.
Little private joke. 8 years ago, under hip hop, you released Pills of the Pied Piper. Do you remember this one?
Yeah.
It's got some comments too. Oh, wait. Someone a minute and a half in said War on Drugs. Okay. We'll flip through to that. This is fun as shit, someone said. Let's skip into here.
This whole thing of War on Drugs.
Drugs.
Blackburn going on for 38 years. All right. Last one we'll do is the oldest thing you've got on here is called Breakfast. No, it's called Metanoia.
Yeah, I like this song. I remember doing this and I was like, how long ago is that? It's going to be 10 years ago, right?
That is 10 years ago.
Yeah, man. 10 years ago. Insane.
You were just a little whippersnapper.
I think I was better at guitar back then than I was now.
Oh, no. Yeah, it was cool to find that earlier. I'll send it to you on Instagram or something so you can verify if you decide whether you want to get ownership of that again.
I remember being real heavily influenced by that. There was a guy called Flume that came out here, like in Australia. So it must have been around that 2011, 2012 period. Did you ever listen to Flume, his first record?
Yeah, I would be lying if I said I can remember it exactly, but I'm aware of the name in this moment.
Yeah, I think he came out with some stuff and I was like, wow, that's sick. And it was interesting. And so I just wanted to replicate that.
I love it when you freeze, but I can still hear you. And you were like this for the last minute.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. We're into the last few minutes here just because I got to go and say goodnight to Harley. Just listening to see if I can hear the electric toothbrush that says to me it's 5 minutes before book time. even though he's probably watching upstairs, actually. Harley, if you're watching upstairs, can you go bang, bang on the floor twice? There'll be a 30-second delay. We'll find out in a second. Yeah, I don't really make any notes when it comes to these chats. I just want to converse and figure shit out. The only thing I wrote down was obviously fifth record, Night Gnomes, April 22nd, 2022. In big capital letters, all riffs, because that's your catchphrase of the last 4 years. We don't know what chords are. We only deal in riffs.
Yeah.
And then also just to touch upon, oh yeah, Ollie Jones, man. So I know you've got a background, your university, and yes, you found yourself doing a bit more music, farting about, creating, and necessarily finishing off what you were doing design-wise. But what did you specialize in at university? And is that where you met Ollie? And how much have you had beyond, I know artwork and a lot of the stuff is all you as well, which is so scintillating. But man, it's incredible when you combine you and Ollie's minds. Have you combined for any of these videos he's done, or is that all him and then it's all you separate? Because it's unreal.
Pretty much. I think we had the original idea for Mr. Prism, of the Alice girl sort of like ate a bunch of people. I think I sent him there was a Simpsons claymation video of like the bullies coming in and hacking up the Simpsons, and it was so gory but it was hilarious. And so we spoke about that, but no, we didn't meet at uni. I did graphic design and he lives in Birmingham, so it was like I think Murray had sort of found, or I'd done some work with him previously. It's like, oh, here's a guy who does claymation if you want to work together. And to be honest, we have like a half an hour phone call. He's like, brilliant, that's all I need to know. And then sort of sends a video over. And you're like, I think I jokingly say to him a lot of the time, like, man, like, can you just change like 30 seconds a minute? Because he know it takes him like 3 months.
Yeah.
He's just like, yeah, that's it. He's just like, all right, sweet. But I love it. I think it's really good allowing, I think with the music videos, because instead of sort of being like, can you do it like this, that, and this, like, and you having the sort of viewpoint of or directing it, it's not going to be as much fun for the person probably working on the project. So I think letting them have as much creative freedoms as they want is way better, because then they're going to work, I don't know, rather than feel like a deadline. It's like, I know when I've got a project done, it's like you're up till 3 a.m. because you want to finish something because you love doing it, rather than being like 9 to 5 and like, man, I've got to keep doing the Paul Crawford's video. It's like, I think with Ollie, it's the same, just letting him go to town with the idea. And then, like, he's just done one for this new record called Acid Dent, where this guy has, he works at some just an acid factory. I don't know, he's playing something. He falls in the old vat, and then everything he touches melts. But we were like talking about like what could happen. And it was like, instead of going out into the world and him sort of being like, oh, he can go in, like he saves everything. He's like acid man, his hands are just melting stuff. We were like, it would be more hilarious if it was actually practical, like what would happen. Like he would wake up, try to cook dinner, and it's like the panhandle's melting and he can't hold the fire extinguisher and everything's on fire. It's like actually, I don't know, it just feel like more of the skit rather than being like he can control it. He's like, no, he's freaking the fuck out. He's like, everything I touch is melted. So yeah, so it went that way. And he's credited. Yeah, it's so good. It's so fun.
And with the few that you've collaborated with him for, then it sounds like you just give him a quick 2-3 sentence footnote synopsis, like just and have at it.
Yeah, and maybe how things sort of like how they end or like, and I think a lot of the time we sort of talk a bit beforehand, but yeah, there's a lot more leeway with whatever he wants to do. I think I'm more sort of a yes man. If he's like, I've got this idea, I'm like, cool, like what about if we change this and that? But that, I know, it just takes him so long, but he's unbelievable. I mean, there's a scene in one, I think it's the Tally-ho video, or maybe the Puke Box video, or one of those where the van is going through space and like, yeah, the old character and the animation sort of battle he had, where it was the dog bounty hunter kind of guy.
Yeah.
The level of detail, some of those animations was unbelievable. Yeah. It's a nice pairing, I think. I don't think I've watched a music video in a long time. Like, I sometimes will, but I'll listen to the song. It's like, I don't know, music's always sort of the music for myself. Other than before, I used to like watch Kerrang religiously.
Yeah.
I loved that. Like, I think I just don't do that anymore. But yeah, so having something that just feels like it's a bit, it's not like us accompanying the music video, just being like, here's how cool we look. It's all fuck ugly. So it's just way easy to be like, go and do some animations. Like get that, make it just interesting and comical. I think that's sort of the way that we tried to go.
Well, both those boxes were ticked quite substantially. I think
that's
kind of the dream though. Like in the fortuitous career that I've had so far, I dream of meeting that person that just knows where I'm going before I've gone there. And in terms of when I would do interviews at festival sites visual interviews rather, or like little skits for festivals, or if you get hired to go and do this for a local whatever. And there's a guy, a dear friend of mine that I've worked with for 10 years called Dave Wallace, and he just knows what my comedic mind is going to go. He just knows. And actually, we were watching all the videos before the stream, well, earlier on in the stream before you joined us. And Steve, Trucker Steve in the chat had said, weed, Gromit, we need more weed, which I thought was so good.
I like that.
So now I really want to see Ollie make, like, if you've got Dog the Bounty Hunter in there somehow.
Yeah.
I love that it's a saga at this point. Like, they've got characters in three of your videos. We can somehow squeeze in a dodgy looking Wallace and Gromit situation, just digging up weed on the moon or something. I don't know. They go to Mars and it's just made out of weed, not cheese. I don't know what it could be.
Yeah. I think that's now because we wanted to do like a little skit show, like with Ollie. So basically, we'll just have the porn crumpets because I think me and Luke love. But huge fans of Monty Python and Mighty Boosh and that kind of stuff.
Oh, I love the Boosh.
Yeah. So we were like, if we could create some sort of minute long little things that we just try and get Adult Swim to work with, and like, it'll be me, Luke, and Ollie just sort of writing these little claymation skits that we could sort of have separately to Crumpets, would be amazing. And we did a couple of them. They're, I don't know, it's stuff that you just can't act. It's like you could do anything with claymation, so it would look hilarious. Like, but that was the next sort of step with Ollie, if we could do something like that.
That would be so cool. That is a bucket list of me, is that one day this is not me saying pick me, I'm just saying it's been a bucket list dream since I was a kid to get on the radio and to be a Pixar animated voice character. would be so good. And I have dreamt, as we even started at the start of this conversation. Oh, one thing I need to just, before I remember this half an hour ago, I was going to say this just to correct myself. We were talking about John Williams earlier, and I said Gladiator, which is Hans Zimmer. When you said Hans Zimmer, I realized I'm a moron. I'm going to retract that statement. John Williams had nothing to do with the Gladiator soundtrack. That's Hans Zimmer. Thank you, Jack. Yeah. But then also, now you see I've lost the point of where we were going with this.
Dimension.
Yeah. It would just be so cool. Oh, yeah, I've always dreamt of, for years I worked stacking shelves in Tesco and Sainsbury's when I was a kid. And I've always said, and I found a book the other day, like a little notebook where I'd written out four or five scenes. I would love to do a animated documentary sort of office piss take series on my time working stacking shelves, and do it with Edgar Wright, Simon Pegg, and Nick Frost. And the one scene that I'll never forget, and maybe I'll leave you with this little nugget and we can continue this chat another time when the record's out. I think that would be wonderful if you're down with that in a few months once the tour's done.
I'd love to.
But when I used to work in Tesco, it was approaching Halloween and we'd sold out of pumpkins. I don't know how. We'd sold thousands of fucking pumpkins. And this dad came in stressed out of his mind on Halloween. He needed something. And I just flippantly said, well, why don't you grab a watermelon and fucking paint it?
Yeah.
So he did. and he came back the next week and showed me pictures, and I was like, oh my god, I need to write this sitcom. And
that's brilliant.
Anyway, that is what it is. I
be cheaper than a pumpkin as well?
Sorry,
I said would a watermelon be cheaper than a pumpkin, but I think it froze and I'm about 5 minutes behind now, so
I honestly can't remember. Yeah, I wonder.
You've just upsold him, and you've been like, "Why get a pumpkin when you pay more for?"
How much is a watermelon in England? That's what I'm going to type right now. Tesco watermelon. Thank you, Tesco.com. How much is that? This is by far. Oh, they're £3, $7. Oh. Wow. Yeah. How much is a pumpkin at Tesco right now? Oh yeah, I guess shit. I made the company a few quid extra that day. Oh,
and the paint, nice.
Yeah, well, we were a proper Tesco with everything you could possibly imagine. Do you want home insurance, car insurance, pet insurance, or paint? We got it. Anyway, those were the old days. No, Jack. I mean, it's I could converse with you for another 2, 3, 4, 5 hours, but I want to go and give Harley a bedtime hug before he gets off, and it's just been such a pleasure to speak with you. I will be frank with you. I didn't want to start with this, but what time were you told that we were going to start?
Literally, Murray told me today. I think I was like, sweet, just 10:30. So that's what time he said.
Perfect. I got told an hour before you.
All right. Okay.
So we were hanging out and just going through every music video that you've got and just... So I'm not saying there's a reason why I'm saying this at the end, because it's not a fucking issue.
And okay, cool. I'm sorry about that.
Oh god, no. There's zero issue. But the joke is, I said, like, I know right as I end the stream, you're gonna pop in. And then when you popped in, I was like, this is great, because I didn't want to reschedule it. I wanted to do this right now because we've been trying to do it for a little while.
But legend.
No, I think, you know, you mentioned the Lazy Eyes. I had a great chat with those guys a few months ago. They are so talented. I love how, and that's where you have similarities to them in the extension of your personality, not giving a shit about what the outer world is going to think. You're creating for you and yourself first and foremost. You're galvanizing to push yourself first and foremost. And that's what attracts me to artists, is when they're just singing from their soul. They're not painting for someone else. And right now there is just so many incredible bands in and around your neck of the woods of Australia that I've spoken to in the last few months. I've become dear friends with Loser, if you're not familiar with Loser, and with also the wonderful guys in Sophisticated Dingo,
but yeah.
And soon to be Dear Seattle as well, I think. But yeah, it's just such a pleasure to speak to you, because for the last 2.5 years I've been driving around going, oh man, this is so fucking crazy, I love this. And it's just so great to finally connect with the mind behind it. So I really appreciate your time, man.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me on. I'll tell you, this is one of the best chats I've ever had. I never thought so much about myself, which I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing. But it's been, I've learned a lot.
CJ says, amazing to see this. Thank you for the amazing music, Jack. Keep up the great work, says CJ in the chat. Thank you, CJ. Cheers. Thanks for watching with us. But yeah. I really appreciate that. And something that I would love to do in a two prong is let's get back together in 6 to 9, 12 months and go over the new music. Then what I'd love to do is get back together maybe in and around next Easter, depending on where your world's at, and I'd like to bring in members of bands that I've spoken to from all across the world. I think someone that you need to know about. That's what I always do is give you bands that I think you should go and look up, which I can message to you as well. Do you know Spiral Drive from Germany?
No, but I think you're the second person that's told me to listen to them, though. I need to.
You must listen to Spiral Drive. A new record came out last Friday. Just incredible. I had a great conversation with Raphael a few weeks ago. And what I loved about, we were talking about he was singing, he didn't want to sing in German like, everybody, let's go, eins, zwei, drei, vier. It was hilarious. He's like, I want to sound like it's 1, 2, 3, 4. And so he was asking me about his English. I said, it's amazing, don't worry. And he went, well, you're a great conversation partner. And that's that. I've never been called that in my life. And I love that. But his music and that band is so good. So that's one that let me just bring up. Do you know the Velveteers?
No.
The Velveteers are a 3-piece from Boulder, Colorado. They're signed to Dan Auerbach of Black Keys' Easy Eye Sound. Baritone guitars, 2 drum kits, and a hell of a fucking record is their debut. And then what was the other one I wrote down to tell you about? I've told you Spiral Drive. I've told you that. Oh, where's the third one I wrote down for you? Let me check here. That's only because it's the end of the day. Brain fart. Where did that go? Oh, well, I can message it to you another time. But
I'm getting Spiral Drive and the Velveteers cranking after this. I'm going to walk to the shop.
Oh, there it is. The Tasers from Johannesburg. The Tasers. Psychedelic, classic psychedelic rock vibes. I had a great conversation with them about 4 months ago, and I told them about you, and I told them also about Spiral Drive, and it's my dream to bring that triangle together. I think you can all learn something from each other, and also maybe then you've got touring partners, because they're both those bands are desperate to hit different markets, and it's about being savvy and smart, as you know. So hopefully everyone hits it off. And
thank you. That's fucking the nicest thing, though. The hardest thing is trying to find bands and work with each other, because we're at the moment, like, do you know Mother's Cake? They're like from
Now get this, Jack. Raphael of Spiral Drive produces their albums and is in their band.
Oh, there you go. So I've been talking to him about getting together, because I love their record they put out. So we've been trying to get Corn Crumpets, Mother's Cake, like a tour happening in Europe. So
you must get Spiral Drive with you. You must.
All right.
And if there's any way you can bring those bands here to in and around Vancouver, then I can latch on to you and bring you onto the island, and we can try and do a fucking bumper show here as well.
Yeah. All right. Wicked. I dig that. Thank you very much. Have you got anyone else as well? I've got anyone that sounds like Prodigy. I want to start doing that kind of stuff, but like bandish rather than overly production.
Have you heard of Strange Bones and Calvin Louise from England?
Calvin Louise, we played with Calvin Louise in Germany, actually. Yeah.
Oh, no way. They're wonderful souls.
Yeah, they're really nice.
Well,
they did. Yeah, what was the other one? Strange Bones.
Strange Bones. So those two bands live together. Jess, the lead singer of Calvin Louise, is dating Bobby, who's the lead singer of Strange Bones. England Shakes is the song you go to first. England Screams or England Shakes? Let me double check that. Strange Bones. Yeah, England Screams. England Screams is where you want to go to that. There's the Strange Bones and Calvin Louise collab called 9 Lives. And Strange Bones are just this really fucking intriguing... I say this lovingly. They are a real mess. such an intricate mess of this industrial meets indie rock, and you just can't place them. And I think with England Screams and 9 Lives, their management has said we need to place you, or they've decided, but everything else is just
what? I like that same description could be used for that band Squid, you know them?
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
like yeah. where they're like, this is unbelievable, but what the fuck was that 9 minutes beforehand?
Yeah, like, it's just organized chaos.
Yeah, it is.
And then that makes me think of Black Maps that the Tasers told me about, who I think if you think in that realm as well, I've only looked into four or five of the songs.
Is it Black Maps or Mass? Because I saw Black Mass play a festival. It's that one guy, like, it was just like, oh, it was like the future. It was like watching the future.
You said Black Math. Is that what you said?
Math.
Oh, right. Well, I've got it wrong. It's Black Math.
Okay, Black Math. I'll listen to Black Math.
Yeah, they've only released a couple of EPs, a couple of records, but yeah, there's a starting point. And then cheekily beyond that, please consider going to whatwasthatradio.com and you could check out my write-ups on 111 bands from 2021 if you want to. But
I will do.
Yeah, no, Jack, it's such a delight. Thank you so much, man. And please don't take any negative energy away from me letting you know about the mix-up at the start, because that's not why I said it. It's just because transparency is key. And if the label says to you, oh, where were you? You can say, it doesn't matter. I was there. I was where I need to be.
Yeah. Cheers, man.
Sweet.
Do you want me to send over the audio to you, or are you all good?
Yeah, sweet. I mean, I'll. What's the best thing to do? Send you an Instagram message with my email address or what?
I'll save that now.
Yeah, it's just whatwasthatradio@gmail.com.
Yeah, shoot that through on Instagram and I'll email it over to you.
Okay, perfect.
Where is it?
I'll do that right now then. Lo-de-de-de-de.
Yeah, brilliant.
When you open Instagram and you see a friend has face swapped with his wife and you weren't expecting that. Where are you on here? Porn Crumpets. Oh God. If you search porn, that's, obviously that's always been an issue. If you just search porn, isn't it? You fucking prank. Oh, I don't know if you noticed when I was releasing the top 21 last year and you had retweeted and shared it a few times on Twitter and my dyslexia had spelled psychedelic five different ways. Did you notice me on all those mistakes doing that or not?
Didn't do the Twitter page. I think Murray's on the Twitter, but I try and stay off the social media as much as possible. It's a nightmare, but I'll start going back on it.
Okay. What was that? radio@gmail.com. There we go. Lovely. Jack, go and have a, what is it now? 11:30 nearly for you or what?
12? It's just gone 10 past 12. Quarter past 12.
Okay, sweet. This is classic me saying goodbye for 15 minutes. I'm going to let you go now. Thank you so, so much, man. I really appreciate it.
Okay. Cheers, John. Thank you very much. I'll speak to you soon.
Yeah, ciao for now, mate.
Bye.
Bye. Woof. I think I drank 8 cups of tea during that conversation with Jack of Psychedelic Porn Crumpets. What a delight. What a wonderful soul he is. And thank you so much for your time. Whether you are actually at the end of this having watched it the whole way through or you skipped a little bit here and there, thank you. It means so flipping much to me. And whatever you're doing the rest of the day, please, if you've watched all these extras in the last, if you just check whatever I've uploaded in April, you'll see a recurring thing with these extras. That's why the cheeky smile there. Oh, the point being that I just haven't fucking gone to the end screen when it's right. I know that you don't. It'll make any odds to you, but now you know about it, so we're all good. Whatever you're doing the rest of your day, and as always, please look after yourself. And I hope there's some fun and smiles involved in the rest of it too, because we've got to cherish that positive. For now. Cheerio.